How'd you meet Mel Brooks?
I was in a play called Mother Courage by Bertolt Brecht, starring Anne Bancroft, whose boyfriend was Mel Brooks. And Mel came by to pick her up each evening after the show. And I was having trouble with one little section in the play. And he said, he gave me tips on how to act Brecht. He said, that's a song and a dance. He's proselytizing about communism. Just skip over that. Sing and dance right over it and get on to the good stuff. And he was right. That's the irony. And I did.
And what was the first thing he cast you in?
Well, then he said, would you like to come to Fire Island with Annie and me? I'll read you the first 30 pages of a movie I'm writing. And I went to Fire Island. We went fishing on the surf, came back, had dinner, and then Annie and I sat down and he read 30 pages of Springtime for Hitler. That's what it was called then. And then he said, would you like to play that part of Leo Bloom? I said, absolutely. He said, all right. So don't take anything in the fall without checking with me. September came and I was offered One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest, not the movie, the play with Kirk Douglas. So I called Mel and said, I feel a little silly, but you said, yeah. Can you get a 4-week out in your contract? I said, no one knows me, I can't. No, they said, can you get a 2-week out? He said. I said, maybe a 4-week, because I'm not a star. All right, we'll have to live with it, he said. 3 years went by.
You did Cuckoo's Nest?
Yes, yes. 3 years went by, I never heard from him, I didn't get a telegram, I didn't get a telephone call. And I'm doing Murray Schuskal's play called Love on Broadway, matinee, taking off my makeup, knock, knock on the door, I open the door, there's Mel with a tall stranger. I said, Mel. He said, you don't think I forgot, do you? And he said, this is Sidney Glazier, our producer. We're going to do Springtime for Hitler now. He said, but I can't just cast you. You got to meet Zero first. Tomorrow, 10 o'clock, so my heart was pounding. I got to the office door of Sidney Glazier's office. The door opens. There's Mel. He says, come on in. Z, he called Zero Z. This is Gene. Gene, this is Z. And I put out my hand, tentatively, and Zero grabbed my hand, pulled me to him, and kissed me on the lips. And all my nervousness went away. And then we did the reading, and I got the part, and everything was fine.
How did you feel when you went to see the Broadway show?
I was nervous at the beginning when we sat down. Mel wanted me to see it in preview. Curtain went up, first laugh came, and I said, there's no need to be nervous, because this is not the movie. It was great. I thought it was just great.
Did you, when you watch Matthew Broderick do Bloom?
Yes.
And you created Bloom.
Yeah.
How did it feel to see, for the first time ever,
someone
else do this nervous, crazy accountant?
Yes, it felt good because he was singing and dancing and acting so well. And he had trouble with his voice a long time. And when I went backstage, he said, how did you do it? I said, I only had to do it 3 times, once in rehearsal and 2 takes. You have to do it 8 times a week. That's the difference. And I thought he was wonderful.
The Bloom screams.
Yeah, when he gets hysterical.
Yeah.
And that's when he lost it. That's when Matthew lost his voice.
Who came up with the little blanket that Bloom carries?
That was written into the script. That
was
Mel. That was Mel. How it was done was me. How it was acted was me, but that was all in the script.
Now, which came first, Blazing Saddles or Young Frankenstein?
Blazing Saddles, just before.
Did you like that right away?
I did, but I wanted to play the Waco kid, the part that I did play. And Mel said, no, you're too young. I want an over-the-hill alcoholic. I got Dan Daly, who's going to play it. He wanted me to play Harvey Korman's part.
The governor?
Yeah, I said, I'm all wrong for this.
Yeah, you wouldn't have.
And 6 weeks went by. Dan Daly begged off because he had just finished directing something. So they got Gig Young. Gig Young got into the costume, makeup. On the way to the jail cell, and foam started coming out of his mouth. He was on the wagon suddenly and withdrawing. And Mel thought he was acting, you know, some method actor. He said, good, keep doing what you're doing. And then he passed out, and Mel said, it's a sign from God. He called me from the phone on stage. He said, can you come tomorrow? I said, I'm supposed to go to London to do The Little Prince with Stanley Donen directing. Beg off. I called Stanley. He said, do you really want to do it? I said, well, I want to help out Mel. I said, all right, I'll put you at the end of the schedule instead of at the beginning. The next day I was on a plane, and the next day I was hanging upside down in the jail cell.
That was a great character, the Blazing Saddles guy. And you worked great off the whole cast. Yeah. Why did that work so well? I mean, it was crazy with the passing wind and the hitting of the horse. And
well,
one flavor Howard Johnson.
It was
some of the great lines ever written, right?
Yes.
Here they come into town, rape our castle.
And
they rape our cattle.
Madeline,
rustle our women.
Madeline Kahn was worth the price of admission when she sang, "I'm tired." But I think it was because it was perhaps the first surrealistic Western. It started a whole trend after that. I mean, when they break through the walls and come out and get me out of this set, and it takes Harvey Korman takes a taxi cab to Grauman's Chinese Theater.
Buys raisinettes.
Yeah, and buys raisinettes, you know. It was a different kind of movie.
It sure was.
And the people who made it had predicted that it would do something like $2.2 or $2.7 million domestically. Well, it did $40 million first round, or $60 million first round, $40 million the second round. It was an amazing film.
Could you always ride a horse?
Always, yes.
You rode pretty good.
I rode. And in Frisco Kid and in The Woman in Red, I had to ride badly. And then you have to really ride well in order to ride badly.
Ah, The Woman in Red.
Yeah.
Frisco Kid. And we'll talk about Young Frankenstein too. Gene Wilder is our guest. Don't go away. I'm reminded by our crack staff, you were once the hottest male property in Hollywood, right? You were the highest paid movie actor.
Ooh.
You broke box office records.
Yeah.
You had string of hits.
Yes.
How did you handle all that? How did your ego deal with all that?
Very well. Unlike all the stories you hear about it, I don't mean this to sound... I don't want it to come out funny, but I don't like show business. I love acting in films. I love it.
But you don't.
I love painting. I like the show, but I don't like the business. And when I go to a restaurant and they're talking 3.6, 9.8, and how many, what the budget, and everyone is a writer or a director or an actor or a producer, and it just makes me nervous. And Gilda left me this beautiful 1734 house in Connecticut where I live with Karen. And there's no show business there. And there I'm very relaxed. I'm very relaxed with you. But we're talking about art, but we're not talking about the business of show.
Which that's you
the
don't part like
I
all.
Don't like it.
So therefore, being the number one box office one year meant nothing to you?
Well, that was with Richard, and I don't think it would have happened to me alone if I didn't have Richard.
All right, but it still happened.
It happened, yes.
You never said to yourself, I'm a star?
No, because all actors are insecure. I think you must have heard this from other actors, but all of them are insecure, the best of them, because you think it's all a fake and they're going to discover me and whatever. And I just say, well, go about your business, do the best you can. You'll probably never get another job, but anyway, go.
Henry Fonda said he'd be nervous if he didn't have a script to read. It meant people forgot him.
Yeah. But we all go through that.
All right, how did Young Frankenstein come about?
Well. I had just done Everything You Always Wanted to Know About Sex with Woody Allen.
You were the Woolite guy.
Yes.
I fell in love with a sheep. Bed with a sheep.
Yes.
Drinking Woolite to close the movie.
And that's not an easy task, being in bed with a sheep, especially if you make the sheep nervous. I'm not going to go on,
okay.
But you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, okay.
And I finished the film. I loved it. I went back east, and it was... March or April, and I had a little place in West Hampton Beach, Long Island. And after lunch, I took a yellow legal pad and a blue felt pen, and I wrote Young Frankenstein on top. And then for two pages, I thought, what could happen to me if I suddenly found out I was an heir to Beaufort von Frankenstein's whole estate in Transylvania? And I finished the two pages. I called Mel. I told him, he says, cute. It's cute. That's all he said. And then later on that summer, Mike Medavoy, who was my agent at the time, you got anything for you and Peter Boyle and Marty Feldman? I said, what made you think of that company? He said, because I now handle you and Peter and Marty. I said, well, with a wonderful artistic basis, as it happens, I think I do. Send it to me. I said, no, give me another day or two. And I wrote two more pages. The Transylvania Station, almost verbatim, the way it is. And it put an ending on it.
Track 29.
Yes, yes. And Mike Medavoy called me and said, I think I can sell this. What do you think about Mel directing? I said, yeah, I'd love it, but you're whistling Dixie, because he won't direct something he didn't conceive of. Now, you have to remember that Mel spent 2 years on The Producers and made $25,000 a year. He spent the next 2 years on The 12 Chairs, $25,000 a year. Neither one made a penny. Joe Levine made money, but yeah. Mel didn't. They were offering him $250,000 or $25,000 or whatever to direct this. And he said yes. He called me. He said, what are you getting me into? I said, nothing you don't want to get into. Oh, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. Next day, they said, we signed Mel. And
and then you used the original Frankenstein set, right?
No, not the set. No, Dale Hennessy made a great set, but the original scientific equipment.
All
those bubbles and glass and everything. That was all the original
Peter
stuff.
Peter Boyle, genius to play Frankenstein.
He's
genius.
He was the best. He was the quintessential monster.
When you feed him the thing when he's doing the dance.
Yes, M&M's.
Now, how about Marty Feldman, the late Marty Feldman?
Yeah.
He died too young.
He carried a cigarette lighter around his chest. He smoked 3 packs a day. He was in Mexico doing a film, locked the door, and he got a heart attack and no one could get in. And when I got to him, it was too late. But
who's he like to work with?
Who would I?
What was he like to work with?
Oh, he was...
What hump? I can fix that.
Now, you know, you know all the lies.
I know it all.
He was a very shy man. But like a lot of us, when the camera's rolling, he's not shy. Or if he had one too many to drink. I don't drink that much, but when he went to a party and he was nervous, 20th Century Fox is giving a big whatever, he'd start shouting things out and cursing and... But he was an angel. He was almost literally an angel on earth.
Well, what did it feel like to get an Academy Award nomination early in a career? You had one for The Producers.
Yeah, it was wonderful. I just was praying that I wouldn't get the award because I'd have to get up and make a speech, and I was too nervous to make the speech.
But you didn't want to win.
Well, you know, I say that I didn't want to have to get up and make the speech. Sure, I wanted to win. If they had said I was in England doing something and accepting on behalf of Gene Wilder, here's Mel Brooks, and so on, you know, that would have been fine.
Willy Wonka, which is still many people consider their favorite film. How did that come about?
I was offered the part. I had read the book, and Mel Stewart, the director, came to my home in New York. And he said, you want to do it? I said, well, I'll tell you, I'd like to do it if I can come out and all the crowd quiets down and I'm using a cane. Oh my God, Willy Wonka is crippled. And I walk slowly and you can hear a pin drop and my cane gets stuck in a brick and I fall over on my face and do a forward somersault and jump up and they all start to applaud. He said, Mel Stewart said, what do you want to do that for? I said, because no one will know from that point on whether I'm lying or telling the truth. He said, are you saying you won't do the film if you can't do that? I said, that's what I'm saying. Okay, we'll do it. And I meant it.
You're an unusual guy.
Yeah, yeah, well.
Gene Wilder's our guest. What can you say? We'll be right back. Don't go away.
Step on it, Velma. Velma, step on it, Velma. Step on it, Velma.
I am.
Step on it, Velma. Step on it, Velma.
I'm getting.
Come on. Velma, step on it, Velma. Velma,
come on.
Velma.
Your first movie, Gene Wilder, was Bonnie and Clyde, right?
Yes, that's right.
Not a funny.
No. But I was amusing in it.
Yeah, because you had to play that offbeat.
Yeah, I was an undertaker.
Yeah. Do you enjoy playing serious? Your fame is in comedy.
Yes, I enjoy it, but there's 14 other guys who will always do it better than me. But if it's a comedy, it's a different story. Right.
And what do you think that is? Since you say you're not funny, you're not a comedian, you could never do stand-up.
No.
You would die.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So what do you have? What is it that you have? Because you're very introspective about you. What makes you...
I studied for altogether maybe 18 years. I got accepted into the Actor's Studio. I would approach doing Leo Bloom in The Producers in the same way as I would do Death of a Salesman. But the choices would be different. I would make comic choices. But the acting process, create a human being who's real, not only to the audience, but real to me.
Leo Bloom doesn't think he's funny.
No,
he's
no.
He's real.
No, right, absolutely. And so I think, if you want to say you're a method comic actor, yes, without getting into what method is, but a Stanislavski comic actor, yes, because I'm trying to do it the same way I would.
What worked so well between you and Pryor?
Well, that's a real mystery. I hope this comes out right, but it's a little bit like sex. You know, when you meet someone and the chemistry is there, you don't know why, you don't know how, but it's there. I met him the night before we did our first scene. We hugged, we did the first scene, and he said something and I said something, and it wasn't in the script after the camera started rolling. And it went very well. And he said, did you know you were going to say that? I said, no. Did you know you were going to say that? He said, no. I never improvised in a film before. In classes I did, but not in a film. But with him, I always improvised. Because if you don't, you're not going to be anywhere, not with Richard.
How many movies have you made?
I don't know.
Sherlock Holmes you did.
Sherlock Holmes' Smarter Brother, yes. The World's Greatest Lover.
World's Greatest Lover.
Woman in Red with Kelly LeBrock.
What a movie that was.
Yeah, and...
You ever turned down anything you felt sorry about?
Never. I've turned down lots of movies, but none that I felt sorry about. Some I wish I had done that I wasn't offered. I wanted to do... There was a film called Magic that Anthony Hopkins did.
Yeah, scary
and,
movie.
And the director wanted me, the writer wanted me. Joe Levine
Puppet
said,
that killed.
Yeah. Joe Levine said, no, I don't want any comedians on this. I'm not a comedian, but that's what it needed, was someone who was trying to be funny, but it was really tragic.
And what do you do now, Gene? What kind of parts do you get?
I paint watercolors.
You don't act?
Yes, I do. I'm acting now for you. Now, what kind of parts?
Yeah.
Well, I love doing the murder mysteries. But I know I'll always be better and happier when I'm doing a comedy. But I like it to be a comedy with some substance, not a silly... I mean, I like farce. I just did, with Carol Kane and Bob Dishy, Gene Sachs directing, I did a one-act Chekhov play called The Marriage Proposal.
Where?
At the Westport Country Playhouse, where Joanne Woodward is artistic director.
But what kind of movie offers do you get?
Well... Not ones that I want to do yet, but that'll come.
Mel going to do another movie? Another film?
I doubt it.
Too much success with Broadway? He's a Broadway.
Yeah. Where's he going to go?
He's a mogul. Now.
After this. That's what he said, anyway.
Happy for him?
Oh, very happy. Very happy if he can enjoy it.
What do you mean?
Well, you know, success is a terrible thing. And a wonderful thing. If you can enjoy it, it's wonderful. If it starts eating away at you and they're waiting for more from me, or what can I do to top this, then you're in trouble. Just do what you love. That's all I want to do.
This is a tough business. It's a business you don't like, but it's a tough business. What do you like about doing it? What do you like about being Bloom? Or being Frankenstein's son?
I love acting, especially if it's a fantasy of some kind, where it's not just realistic, not naturalism. I love acting in the 30s, too. I mean, 1930s. But I like, it's not that I want to be someone different from me, but I suppose it partly is that. But I love creating a character in a fantastical situation, like Dr. Frankenstein, like Leo Bloom, a little caterpillar who blossoms into a butterfly. You know, I love that. I love the art of acting in, and I love film, because you always have another chance if you want it. You know, if this isn't going well, you can't say, well, you could say, let's stop. Let's start over again, Gene, because you were too nervous.
Well, we don't tape a lot. We mostly live.
I know. And that's, you know, it's difficult. But I love movies because you have another shot at it. Let me try something else. And you try something completely different. And I love that part of it.
You also have to know it's funny because the crew ain't laughing.
No, not out. Well, sometimes in Young Frankenstein, they laughed out loud and ruined a few takes.